Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome today to this service in celebration of the life of Loraine Pilon. My name is Andrew Twiddy. I'm priest and pastor here in the Anglican community at St. Anne and St. Edmund in Parksville. We're delighted that Loraine has been a little part of our journey in recent years here, and so it's so fitting that we give expression to her lifelong faith by gathering in this place and giving voice to her wishes, about which she was very clear in terms of the choice of both music and readings and how we should celebrate. So we honor her very precisely by doing as she has asked us, and it's our great privilege to do that. So on behalf of Mary, Corey, and all the family, a thank you to everyone here in person and everyone online. For those of us here in person, there will be a reception after our service, and I hope for those of you at home, you'll have a cup of tea or something else to continue the memories and storytelling of Loraine's life. I invite those of us gathered here, if you would like to turn to page 2 of your white leaflet. Page 2 of your white leaflet. And let us stand in honor of the presence of the ashes of all that can die of Loraine Agnes. And we'll do so in a moment of quietness, which will begin and end with the sound of the bell. The song is Spirit of Gentleness. In your yellow inserted leaflet, the words for Spirit of Gentleness. Thank you. together in these words of faith and hope. God of love, you have searched us and known us. You know when we sit down and when we rise up. You trace our journeys and our resting places, and are acquainted with all our ways.
Even before our words on our tongues, O God, you know them to be faithful.
For it was you who formed our inmost being.
You knit us together in our mother's bosom.
Where can we go from your spirit? Or where can we run from your presence? If we take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, if we say, surely the darkness will cover us, and the light around us become night.
Even the darkness is not dark to you.
The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. Let us pray. God of all consolation, in your unending love and mercy, you turn the nighttime of death into the dawn of new life. Show compassion to your people in our sorrow. Be our refuge and strength to lift us from grief to the peace and light of your presence. Your Son, our Lord Jesus the Christ, by dying for us, conquered death, and by rising again, restored life. May we then go forward eagerly to meet you, and after our life on earth, be reunited with our brothers and sisters, where every tear will be wiped away. We pray it through Jesus and in all the holy names of God. Amen. Let us be seated, and Elizabeth will bring us our first reading from the book of Ecclesiastes.
There is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under heaven, a time to be born, and a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to uproot, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to tear down, and a time to build, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain. A time to search, and to give up. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to mend. A time to be silent, and a time to seek. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time for war, and a time for peace. What does the worker gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on people. God has made everything beautiful in its time. God has set eternity in the human heart. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and do good while they live. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Psalm is Psalm 23, and we sing it as the hymn, "The Lord's My Shepherd." It's in your yellow leaflet. I invite you to stand as you're comfortable and as you're able. Friends, since God loved us so much, we should love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God is actually living in us, and God's love is brought to completeness inside us. By this, we know that we are remaining in God, and God is in us. God has given us the Spirit within us. So we have known and we believe the love that God has for us. God is love. And those who remain in love remain in God, and God is remaining inside of us. Love has been brought to completeness among us so that we have boldness on the day of decision, because as God is, so are we in the world. There is no fear in love. In fact, mature love drives out fear. Fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not yet reached that maturity in love. We love because God first loved us. This is the commandment that we have from God. Those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. Holy Word and Holy Wisdom, let us hear what the Spirit is saying to our hearts this day. Thanks be to God. Now it's Mary's opportunity to tell us a few stories of Loraine's life.
My mother, Loraine Agnes Tugwell, was born into Fino Hospital to Vonda and Thomas, aka Bud, on July 12, 1948. Shortly after she was born, her parents began building their first home in Euclid on Peninsula Road. In her early years, they always had boarders in the house, being one of the few families in town that had a spare bedroom. And when the construction crews came to Euclid to build roads into town, their house was always full. It wasn't until 1956 that the house filled for another reason, when her brother Rick was born. Growing up, Loraine the Brain, as she was commonly referred to, spent most of her time at school or studying. Recently, while looking through my mother's old memorabilia, I came across her old report cards, and I thought I would share. English, A. Social studies, A. Mathematics, A. Science, A. French, A. Physical education, pass. I had a chuckle at that last one until my Uncle Rick informed me that there were no A's in gym class. Some of the comments on her report cards over the years read, "Superior student, cooperates in every way, and excellent results indeed. Would you consider Simon Fraser this coming year?" asked her parents. Not surprisingly, Loraine was a valedictorian. As it turned out, she did attend university after finishing grade 12 in 1966. But rather than attending SFU, she chose the Bachelor of Science program at the University of British Columbia, majoring in mathematics. She studied hard, but she also took the time to have some fun and make lifelong friends in the process. just as she had in her early years. Upon her graduation in 1970, she finished first class in her final examinations and landed on the Dean's Honor List. She didn't spend much time in Vancouver, though, just enough time to finish her education and have some fun. Then the lure of family and small-town life brought her back to Euclid. Loraine lived with her parents in the old house when she moved back home, and with her talent for numbers, it was only natural when she started a career in accounting. As she had been working for the Euclid Co-op during the summer breaks from university, she was able to get a full-time job with the co-op as an accountant when she returned home. Not long after, in 1972, the family began building a new home on Marine Drive. In her 20s and early 30s, Loraine continued to work at the co-op. She spent her free time making new friends, keeping in touch with old ones, and spending quality time with her family. Lots of time was spent at the beach or on the water, and she expressed to me how much she really loved dancing all night long at the UAC Hall or the Army and Navy Club. She also developed a taste for travel, going on trips with her friends and family to Mexico, Hawaii, and the Caribbean. The common element among them was often the beach, her favorite place to be at all stages of her life. Mom bought her first home on Birch Street in the early 1980s, but that didn't keep her away from home. It was normal for her and the rest of the family to gather back at her parents' house for family dinners, something that was always important to her. After a full course dinner, and dessert of course, there were always cards, a family game we call 46, that was played late into the night. Periodically, the family would compare our change jars to see who was the lucky one of the season. Let's just say that it wasn't uncommon to see Mom buying rolls of coins at the local credit union. Around 1983, Mom came across a job posting at Pacific Rim National Park and decided to apply. In true Loraine fashion, she succeeded and got the job. During her time there, she was extremely successful. There was a period of time when she took a deployment to work as the CFO during the transitionary period. After seeing her success in the role, the leadership at the park offered her the job full-time. But knowing that it would take time away from her family and friends, she decided to return to her old job. My mother was a very smart, talented, and capable woman, but her love for the family and her friends always trumped any career ambitions. In 1984, I came into my mother's world on a stormy night in November at the Nanaimo Hospital. Apparently, Grandma didn't let my mother's condition or the weather stop them from being productive while waiting for my arrival. It was up at the break of dawn and out the door to spend the entire day walking and shopping at the mall. Not a moment to waste in our family, a trait I have come to admit that is passed down from mother to daughter. In the late 80s, Mom met a handsome gentleman named Brian Pilon, who she started dating. The two didn't waste much time and married in 1990. She sold the cute house on Birch Street, and we moved in with Brian and his son, Corey, to a Coast Guard house on Rupert. In the years following, Mom and Dad developed a love for road trips and camping. Every summer, the three of us packed up the trailer and traveled Canada and the United States. The days in the single cab truck were long, with the three of us jammed together in 90-plus degree weather. For entertainment, Mom agreed to play Barbies with me, but only after we dedicated an hour or so to math flashcards. Because of her, I will never forget my times tables. In 1998, Loraine took an early retirement package and moved with her family to an acreage in Wembley, Alberta. It was a whole new world for Loraine. New people, new place, new adventure. It wasn't long until she began attending St. Luke's Anglican Church, joined the local community club, and started new hobbies, including snowshoeing, curling, and photography. The family would fly in for special occasions, and the tradition of good food and cards continued, with the addition of board games. Loraine had her mother's luck with games, which wasn't the best, but she also had her grace and good sportsmanship, though no one stood a chance against her once the Scrabble board hit the table. Loraine spent 22 years in Alberta, and after her loving husband passed in 2019, Loraine moved back to Vancouver Island, to Qualcomm Beach, where she would be closer to Mary, Corey, and family. I also moved back to the island shortly after in 2021, which meant that my mother and I had the opportunity to go on many of our favorite hikes along Little Qualicum Falls, Englishman River, and Notch Hill. In 2022, my mom was diagnosed with terminal cancer. It was a shock to us all, but she never lost hope. The doctors recommended radiation in Victoria, and rather than wallow, she did what she always did, made arrangements and got things done. Sadly, the treatments did not work, but she never did wallow. She spent the rest of her days as she spent her life, accepting the things she could not change and finding joy, beauty, and peace in all of the moments she was blessed with. To finish today, I want to read something that my mom wrote for my grandma, because the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. "We will miss you, Mom. Your life was full and rich. Your quiet strength supported us no matter what. We always knew that we could count on you to be there. You taught us to work hard and have fun. Your faith carried you forward throughout your life. We thank you as you return to God. Happy journey. Go with our love."
We all have different ways of expressing grief, and mine's very book, but what is going on? So this one is entitled, "Remember This." All of us must face death. How bravely we do this is the test of our character and our belief. You pass the test, much to our relief. Knowing what you faced, you did prepare. What you believe in helped you there. To face eternity and what it involved, a stepping stone in the mystery will be solved. Go forth, my dear friend, knowing this is the end. You marched through the turtles of life. You had a child and were a good wife. As we deal with the reality that you will be no more, from up above us, you will soar. We had many fun-filled years. We will remember them through our tears. Our memory of you is what is our own. One day we will see you again in the great unknown. Knowing this, we are content to be, as once more, you we will see. I wrote another longer one, you're too welcome to read it, and then we have your snack. But that's you and your friend Frank.
As you've also said, there will be lots of opportunities to continue telling stories as we gather in the reception. And for now, I'd just like to us to listen to a couple of songs, some instrumental music of Loraine Agnes Pilon.
Thank you.
so to do, I invite you to stand for our gospel reading. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside, and there he sat down. And his disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. This is what he said. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after justice, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God, the children, the daughters, the family of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, the kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Blessed, in fact, are you when people insult you, persecute you, or falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me, because you should rejoice and be glad in that case. Your reward in heaven is great. This is how they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Let us hear the wisdom from this gospel reading. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. To give voice before we send Loraine on her onward journey and celebrate with thanksgiving through our prayers her life, to recognize that this was not part of the plan. What we ache and miss for is that she had just come back here and Mary had just come in an animal so that they could be closer together and look forward to spending time together. Loraine came to join us here about 3 years ago, and very shortly after that, before she had had a chance to meet people and know and integrate into our community here, as we all know only too well, we entered into several years of closure and isolation. And if we had church at all, our instructions were to sit six feet apart, not socialize, meet anybody or inside or outside the building. And my loss for Loraine is that she didn't have the opportunity to do things that she would have wished and to spend time. So I want to give voice to our community sadness well, that these last years are ones of constriction for us all, and we bear corporate grief as a human community. Within that, I had the very great privilege of singing a blessing in the parking lot at our drive-by service to Loraine when she came by, and here's your little bag of worship materials to take home, we'll see you online, to visit her in her home, to visit her in hospice, to be close to her representatively on behalf of others who could not do that or get to know her. So that was a great privilege for me, as well as a great sadness. I'd like to comment on the scriptures, but before I do, I'd like us to give voice to that sense that we're parting before we wish to. And so Mark, our soloist, is going to sing for us and invite us to listen. Lay still, my dear. We would love for Loraine to stay. And in a paradoxical way, she does in fact stay because she lives on within our hearts and our minds, in our courage and our consciences and our games playing, our memories. And in some ways, perhaps she even builds a bridge for those closest to her into the next life. I don't know what your experience is, but in a strange way, my mother, who lived for most of the last 40 years, about 10,000 miles away from me, has never been closer to me than these past 4 years since her passing. And that in many ways I ride on her wings, and she lives out her life through me, and my prayer for you as family is, and those close as friends, is that Loraine will continue to allow her spirit to live out through you. The other side of that paradox, that she is more with us, is of course that she is not with us, because she is moving on. All true spirituality is paradoxical. All true spirituality is paradoxical. It is both this and that. It is yes, even when it seems to be no. It is always love, although not every moment of our life feels like love in action, either in the giving or in the receiving. There's a time for everything, the preacher concluded thousands of years ago. There's a time for the tough stuff in life as well as for the good stuff. There are thousands of joys and thousands of sorrows. There are stones to be gathered and then stones at the same time to be cast away. How can this be so? And yet it is. And Jesus, in his very first sermon, in bringing that perspective on what love is, set up happiness as this dance of unexpected paradoxes. That poverty is actually our true wealth, that mourning is our entry into happiness, that being hungry and thirsting for justice, peace, and freedom itself is part of the enactment of that. And we're never more full than when we're empty. So we bring our emptiness today, as well as our fullness. The fullness of joy, of every memory of the good times, and the sweet sorrow of parting, which we give voice to this day. Loraine loved to travel. She was adventurous. I identify with that. I love to go to faraway places and on long car drives and go see new things. And that sense of adventure has come full circle now for her today. And so in this paradox of our missing her and losing her and letting go of her and seeing an ending to her life, she is at the same time setting out on her greatest adventure of all, which is an adventure into eternal love, an eternal well-being in a place of reuniting, in a place beyond all tears and grief and mourning. And in doing so, she builds a little bridge for you and me this day to make it easier for us to accept that same paradox of our own lives, to accept our beginnings and endings, our stone gathering and stone scattering times, to accept the love that moves the sun and the stars, that is the love that moves every one of us, whether we see it or don't, or feel it or don't, and inviting us into the wisdom of that paradox of love that Jesus gives us. And so my last question for us today is, what is it about Loraine's life that calls and invites you to live with greater wisdom and greater love with the time, the unknown time of the years that are left to you? What is it that you can learn from these 74 years of her living that will enable you to live with greater love, greater joy, greater gratitude, and greater faith? Amen.
Thank you.
you are comfortable and as you're able, I invite you to stand as we share together in gratitude page 3 of your white paper. In response to the bidding source of love and compassion is we offer our thanks. Source of love and compassion, we offer our thanks. We offer our thanks today for the life of Loraine. We offer thanks for her loving care and affection for her family and friends, for her devotion as a daughter, a wife, a mother, and as a friend to many. Source of love and compassion,
we offer our thanks.
For her generous and positive attitude, for the resilience and courage she displayed through life's challenges and changes, and for the genuine and respectful consideration by which she encouraged others. Source of love and compassion,
we offer our thanks.
For her hard-working dedication in the workplace, for her loyalty to friends and community, for the energetic and compassionate thoughtfulness she offered in the service of others. Source of love and compassion,
we offer our thanks.
For her independent and adventurous temperament, her attention to detail, her broad and joyous smile and sense of humor, and all that enabled her to touch the heart of others, to celebrate life in all its fullness. Source of love and compassion,
we love our friends.
For each moment of appreciation and inspiration that brought hope and meaning to her spirit, for her deep abiding Christian faith and generous spirituality, and for all that helped her to face life and death with peace and equanimity. Source of love and compassion,
we offer our thanks.
Gathering all our prayers into one, we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints,
where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting.
You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all.
And we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return.
For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return.
All of us go down to the dust, yet even in the grave we make our song.
All shall be well, alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints,
where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting.
For all shall be well.
All shall be well.
Into your hands, loving God, we commend your servant, Loraine. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon her. May her soul and the souls of all the departed through your mercy rest in peace. Amen. Amen. As I bless us to go in peace. Our closing song will be number, for those with the book, number 649. For those of us with the leaflet, it's on your yellow leaflet, breathe on the breath of God. Loraine first sang this in 1956 in the church choir at St. Agnes Pilon, and it's been a favorite since then. I discovered that. So that's my last editorial comment on her behalf. And let us now receive this blessing. May God's hidden presence bless you and keep you. May God's face shine love and compassion on you. May God's smile caress you and give you peace. In the name of the one beyond all naming, strong, vulnerable, and compassionate, Creator, Holy One, and Great Spirit. Amen.